this talk that we have this morning by Scott Stanley from the University of Denver, who's going to speak about sliding versus deciding, how life before I do impacts lasting love. Dr. Stanley is a research professor and co-director of the Center for Marital and Family Studies at the University of Denver. He has published extensively with core research interests including relationship commitment, couple development, and the prevention of marital distress. His recent research has focused on how premarital experiences relate to the quality and stability of marriages. Stanley has co-authored and authored numerous books, including A Lasting Promise, Fighting for Your Marriage, and The Power of Commitment. He writes a popular blog, slidingversusdeciding.com, which you can check out if you like, and he contributes in-depth pieces to the blog of the Institute for Family Studies, where he is a senior fellow. So I'll turn it over now to Scott Stanley. Please welcome him.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm delighted to be here. This is really essentially my favorite talk. So I enjoy giving this talk. I hope you'll enjoy hearing this talk, but you can decide later. I do a lot of research on relationships historically at the University of Denver. I and my colleague Howard Markman have done a lot of work on relationship education, studying programs that we've developed and testing them over time. And then about 2000 onward, started to do a lot of work at the university focusing on relationship development, particularly on relationship development regarding commitment development. And that led us, I really got into doing research on cohabitation starting around 2000. Galena Rhodes had come to the University of Denver at that point, and I'm going to talk a lot about our work this morning and insights that it leads to in terms of all kinds of relationship phenomena, not just about cohabitation. One of the things I want to say as a backdrop to this talk is that one of the things that's transformed in my lifetime in terms of how people do romantic relationships is that things are now very ambiguous. When I was young, things were not nearly so ambiguous. We had lots of different ways to clarify where people were at in relationships. But you can see this ambiguity in lots of ways. I write about it often. I write on several different blogs fairly much, as well as journal articles. One of my most popular blog entries ever is this piece called Is This a Date? Which many of you would understand where that's going in terms of the point. A current piece that's that also got picked up as a separate story then in Psychology Today is the soft breakup, how even breakups are now ambiguous. People aren't even that clear whether the relationship is over or not, which was just picked up, I noticed this week in a different way, about this idea of back burner relationships where people kind of keep a relationship going on the side as sort of like a spare in case this one doesn't work out. Well, I'm maintaining enough contact with you over here through social media, et cetera, that maybe that could start up again if this one doesn't work out so well. Of course, hookups are very ambiguous, or I guess they're not ambiguous in some ways, but they're very ambiguous about what the nature of the relationship is. And cohabitation, which is a major element of ambiguity in relationships at this point. I think the ambiguity that we see throughout the dating, mating, romance, and sex scene at this point in our country it's not just ambiguous, the ambiguity is motivated. That people at this point have a lot of fear about marriage, about commitment, about things working, and that gets channeled into an aversion to risk, that clarity feels more risky than leaving it kind of vague and not being so clear about whether this relationship is really, well, is it a relationship? That's the DTR thing, you know, having that talk and just, are we actually in a relationship? In my day, that would be closest to something that was very commonly understood and much more sort of worked out than what you have today in just simple concepts like going steady. So one reason for ambiguity is keeping options open, and another reason for ambiguity is that it just softens things. In some ways, people risk more rejection when they've been more clear about who they are and what they believe. So ambiguity feels protective. It's also got a lot of risks. Now, one of the ironies about where I think we're at this point in our culture and society is that we have a culture and a society where there's an increasing amount of insecurity about attachment. If you look at all the relationships where the parents never even really came together as a couple. Either they might have been cohabiting, but they may not even have been cohabiting and a child was born, or the still pretty high rate of divorce. You have a lot of people, you have more people than ever before, more young people, exposed to instability now about core family relationships growing up. And I couldn't prove this point to you, nobody has the right kind of data to prove this, but we have to have more people with insecure attachment running around our culture than we ever had before. Simultaneously, we have an unbelievable loss of steps and stages and things that scaffold or provide clarity about commitment and signal about what kind of relationship we're in than ever before. And a simple example, when I was in high school, it was a very common thing that you would see a young woman wearing a class ring of a young man. And how many of you have ever seen that? I saw it once. I was talking to my sons, I have two sons, same high school. I was talking to the high school seniors once about 3 or 4 years ago, and I saw a woman about right there in the audience with a big old class ring on it with all the yarn underneath. It was the whole thing, like took me back right, you know, to whenever that was, a long time ago, when I was in high school. That was common then, which was interesting because all of these things that the culture is kind of increasingly stripping out were mechanisms in terms of scripts and steps and stages and signals of commitment. And people could really clarify between the two what the nature of their relationship is, and they had a way to signal it to others. So I think one of the ironies about where we're living now is that we're going to see, I think, more people than ever before in the history of this country with insecurity about attachment, and then we will also have less and less societal structure, less scaffolding for helping people clarify and strengthen commitments in the first place. Now, I could give a whole talk just off this panel and add many more bullets to it, but there's many reasons why commitment's really important. One is that it's absolutely clear that children do the best when there's two committed parents. Children do the best with married parents. What we have in our society is a growing number of children that are born into what I call, and write about a fair amount, low commitment contexts. So that the way the child's coming into the world, even if the couple's cohabiting, the odds are much greater that they didn't plan to have a child, and the odds are much greater that they didn't actually already form a clarity about a commitment to life together before that child came. So that child is much less likely than other children born into marriage to be raised by their own two parents. And I also just want to say that lifelong love takes work, which is another reason for the obvious necessity of maintaining and keeping commitment. Now, this photograph is my dog, Odie. And this is, in fact, a picture of Odie the first night we brought him home. Now, Odie is nearly as cute as he ever was. He's a 13-year-old dog now. So he's a little old man dog, but he still thinks he's a puppy. And he actually looks nearly that cute. He's a big 18-pound behemoth now, and back then he was a little 4-pound ball of fluff. So when we were looking for Odie, and by the way, this isn't a bad model for a lot of what I'm going to talk about in terms of sliding for versus deciding. We actually were very intentional. We knew what we were doing. That's my wife and I and Nancy. We had two young boys at the time, and we were kind of waiting for Luke, the youngest, to be old enough that we thought the puppy thing would work out fine. We knew we wanted a Bichon because Nancy and Kyle, my oldest son, have pet allergies. So they're allergic to dander. Is this too much sharing? Well, Odie is the kind of dog, like a number of other breeds, that have hair and not fur, and they're much less of a problem. They're kind of hypoallergenic dogs. So we knew what kind of dog we were looking for. We were very intentional. And Nancy had been looking around for a while. She had gone to like different breeders. She had gone to like different doggy recycling places. You know, there's a better name for that, but you know what I mean. And the right dog had not appeared, okay? I know you're not supposed to do this in terms of what animal lovers say and do, but Nancy had been with her sisters at the mall one week, and they went into the pet store, and she saw this little face looking out from the cage. Now, that was the week before. It was, I think it was Labor Day weekend, A week later, her sisters are out of town now, or are gone, and it's me and her and the boys, and we're thinking, we haven't found the right Bichon yet, and she's still thinking about this face in the cage at the mall. So we're not stupid. We went to the mall, well, we can be, but we weren't this day. We knew what we were doing because we went to the mall with the boys and fully intending that if that dog is still there, that dog's probably coming home with us. So that's how Odie came to be in our family. Now, all of that was just to get to this point. I want you to notice something about Odie, or notice something about this as a metaphor for why commitment really matters. You fall in love with the front end of the puppy. But every puppy has a back end. That's just like love, romance, and marriage. There's the front end, the part that's fun and you're attracted to and excited. Odie greets me most every day at the door. He's just happy to see me and he starts wiggling his butt off. I mean, he just goes wild. But you know how a lot of relationships fail with pets is the same way relationships fail in real life, the same way marriages fail. It's not usually that the back end, the front end stopped kind of working, although that can stop working. But the back end doesn't get figured out. The back end's where the work is, where the real commitment is, where it takes time to figure out time and place and regulation and priorities and things. And a lot of families don't make it with dogs because they don't work out the back end. You can't make it just on the front end of the puppy. So why does commitment develop? Now I'm going to give you a psychological viewpoint. I'm not a philosopher. I don't mind reading philosophy, but I haven't taken it in that deeply. I am much more of a scientist than anything, frankly, so I come at things much more that way. And I am a psychologist, so guess what? You're going to kind of get a psychological view of commitment here that will help as we think about some things that we're going to talk about this morning. So let's imagine a particular relationship where two people have met and there's attraction and satisfaction and time together. And one of the things that's a bit delightful about the research about romantic relationships is we still don't really know a whole lot about the attraction part and the mystery part, which I think is actually good. Scientists are sort of pretty interested in resolving all mysteries and making everything clear. And I don't know that that always serves our best interest because sometimes mystery is pretty powerful and pretty wonderful. Part of what's not so mysterious in that circle of how things begin is there's a lot of chemistry involved there. So if you think about a couple that's just met, there's a rush of adrenaline and excitement and anxiety about the relationship. There's dopamine, which is the major chemical in the brain that's involved in your pleasure centers and making you really feel good and euphoric and like you can do anything. And then there's oxytocin, which starts to come into play. And by the way, this is all very overly simplified, but if there's any chemical or hormone in your body of trust and attachment, it's oxytocin. In fact, women's bodies are flooded with it at birth. But men and women have oxytocin, both have oxytocin. And oxytocin is released in substantial amounts when you touch, when you hug, when you have sex. And if you give birth, you're going to have a flood of it because that's on the biological side part of the rapid, massive amount of attachment that usually happens between mother and child. There's a lot of attachment that happens with father also, but there's so much going on biologically in the female. Now, the trick to oxytocin, and just again, I want to say this is overly simplistic, but oxytocin is a very interesting chemical. And there's even researchers, especially some economists, Paul Zak in particular, that have studied the effects of oxytocin on people and find that if you nudge somebody up in oxytocin, which you can actually do in the laboratory with a spray, you can put them in like game theory settings where people are working out, you know, just game theory is used a lot to sort of figure out what kind of deals or bargains people will make in sort of a one-time shot. And if you spritz somebody up a little bit with some oxytocin in a game theory scenario, they tend to make more accommodating bargains in game theory. They tend to be more trusting. Now, again, this is overly simplistic, but it pushes people toward trust. Now, I got some oxytocin spray on the internet.
I don't know if I trust
He said he wasn't sure he trusted me, but he does now. Do you feel it, Ryan? In fact, just so that you're all like really attached to me, and then let's just get a little going in the room. Now,
this is how we believe you.
This is how, right, this is the only thing that makes my talk believable. Forget the science. It's actually literally called liquid trust. I really did get that on the internet. I'm not making that up. I don't really know if it's got oxytocin in it, but they sell it as if it's got oxytocin in it, and they're selling this very idea that chemistry will sort of push people around you towards trusting you. Although one of my graduate students wisely questioned the premise because it mostly says in the bottle to spray it on yourself. You really want to spray it on everybody but you, right? Because you don't want to like... Okay, so you got chemistry in the mix, and there's a lot of power. And the chemistry, one of the reasons why commitment's really important is the chemistry is going to die off. The chemistry is not, doesn't have to go away. But over time in marriage and committed relationships, chemistry is going to not be so much overtaking you. The anthropologist Helen Fisher really talks about and studies the degree to which infatuation and new love sort of overpowers people. And she's noted that pretty much around the world, despite other cultural systems, et cetera, that relationships tend to break up after about 4 years. I mean, that's a very typical time for relationships to end. And she talks about that being the time when the chemistry is starting to wear off, which is, as that chemistry is wearing off, that's where commitment has to really be growing and strengthening over time, because the bond shifts to something that just sort of overtakes you, to things where you're making decisions and you're really deciding in terms of how you're going to follow through on commitment. Now, everybody that's been in love knows this period, this awkward period you reach when you're in love, where you start to become anxious about attachment. And this isn't like Bowlby's attachment anxiety. It's more of an anxiety that I'm so connected to you, I'm so into you, I'm so wanting something to continue with you, that I'm anxious that maybe it's not going to continue or that you don't feel the same way. That kind of anxiety is really resolved in different ways with commitment. So you can move this same model to earlier stages, you could move it all the way up to marriage, but what commitment does is it secures the attachment. So there's some romantic attachment that's going to have some biological elements, and societal forms and methods and systems of clarifying and scripting and upping over time the mutuality and clarity about commitment all sort of secure this strong attachment between two people. So a function of commitment is to secure attachment for adults and for their offspring. Ambiguity makes a fair amount of sense early on. It just doesn't make sense over time. Ambiguity gets people in real trouble over time, because over time what ambiguity does is it makes it much more likely that people are in things like very asymmetrical relationships with regard to commitment and don't know it. So if commitment matters, it matters how it develops, which is really what the rest of this talk's about. This I want to mention just a brief bit about the ways you can measure commitment. I focus a lot on how you measure commitment and what it is theoretically. And broadly, from the measurement perspective, you can break it down into dedication, personal dedication, which is the part of commitment that reflects wanting to be into something. Could be a project, could be a person, could be a marriage, could be a child, family, whatever. You can apply this model to anything. So personal dedication is, I want this, I'm invested in it, I want the long term, I'm joining my identity with this, I'll prioritize, I'll think more negatively about alternatives to what I'm committed to. All those things are aspects of personal dedication. Constraint, on the other hand, is a kind of commitment that kind of keeps you moving forward whether or not you want to continue. Some of you may be fourth year students who aren't so sure that you're as dedicated as you once were to the major that you're in. Don't know how this degree in poetry is going to work on the job market. Whatever it is that you're doing, but if you're fourth year, you got a lot of constraints. Just like in marriage and other relationships over time, there's some element of the things that I'm already doing and have done and invested will become part of what keeps me here regardless of dedication. Now, usually constraints form a very positive function in marriage because they kind of keep the guardrails on and keep people from blowing apart in periods of instability and unhappiness, which are not uncommon in marriage. So constraints are not all negative in any way. In fact, they can form a very positive function. But it's important to understand the difference for what I'm about to cover, which is the sliding versus deciding model. Galena Rhodes is my major colleague in all of this. One of the things that's delightful about the work that we do together, which has really been true my whole life, is I am more traditional, religious, conservative, and male than she is. And older. Did I say older? She's younger, not religious, liberal, and female. And virtually on, I think, about everything I'm about to say through the rest of the talk, we agree on, as do most of the rest of my colleagues who are almost all liberals. Not all, but almost all of them are. Because I'm going to present a model of, based in research on cohabitation that's really pretty palatable for a lot of people to talk about risks that they don't see. So let's talk about cohabitation, and then I'm going to broaden that from that story to applying that to all kinds of romantic and sexual relationship transitions. So there used to be a very well understood, and it's still well understood as something to talk about, effect in social science, that people who lived together before marriage tended, and people puzzled about this for a long time, tended not to do so well. Greater odds of divorce, less marital happiness, more conflict in marriage. Just about anything else you could measure, people who lived together before marriage didn't tend to do as well on. And this has been called the cohabitation effect. Now, this has been a heavily replicated finding for decades. Now, it's started to change a little bit. In some recent research, it appears that the link may have weakened for couples marrying in the past 10 or 15 years. I think overall, the effect has weakened. But I also think it's still there in an interesting way. You'll see a lot of people saying in the media, and this comes up twice a year, there'll be a major blast of findings in the media about cohabitation and whether it's still linked to problems in marriage or greater likelihood of divorce. Truly, twice a year, there'll be a giant media blast about this based on some story that's coming out because it's a very, very popular topic. So the recent blast was in the spring, and this is one of the articles that came out based on a study by Ariel Cooperberg, which basically the headline was, hey, it's no longer risky at all to live together before marriage. This is one of the stories. This one's from Slate, but there were a zillion of them. Call your dad. Now, why just your dad? I don't know. Moms, wouldn't you want to be called to? You should call your mother, too. When you have good news from a social scientist, actually, you should just call everybody, right? So all of you should call people later today if you like anything I say and tell them about it. Living together before marriage does not lead to divorce. Well, let me tell you what the problem with the no added risk headline is. It's only true for a very select group, and actually an increasingly select group. So, and I'm going to explain this one in some deep detail in a moment. It's only true, for example, for those, and I'm talking purely as a researcher, by the way, here, and I will be talking purely as a researcher for a little while with one little chunk of caveats. So there's some areas here where you'll note that I'm not talking theologically. I'm talking as a researcher in this area. Those that begin to cohabit after developing mutual clear plans for marriage, as in engagement, do not look to be at any greater risk from cohabiting prior to marriage, from a social science perspective. Those who only ever cohabited with the person that they married don't seem to be at greater risk. And perhaps, and this was Cooperberg's point, those who didn't cohabit with anyone before the age of 23 don't seem to be at greater risk. Now, I just want to leave this point briefly because I really want to get into the sliding deciding stuff, but what you should recognize is this is a vanishingly, increasingly small group of people in America in terms of how relationships are going. It's actually clear now, just became this year and last year and a couple other studies, that Most cohabitations now aren't going to go to marriage. They're not going to lead to marriage. They're going to lead to breakups before marriage or increased likelihoods of breakups in marriage. But lots of couples, more couples that start to cohabit now are never going to get to marriage, which also means that cohabitations now entered a stage of what I call cohabitating, that it's become more part of dating than even 20 years ago when it was really clearly understood. If you had friends that moved in together, everybody around them, including them, is thinking they're going to get married. That assumption's now pretty much obliterated. And so the headline is true in a way from a social science perspective, but only for a very specific group and an increasingly small group. And many other people are going to cohabit in ways that are actually very well understood to be associated with higher risk. And there's a zillion blog entries I've written on this that are very accessible, very readable. I write a lot about cohabitation. I write a lot about ambiguity. So you should check out the slidingversusdeciding.com if you want some different pieces to share and talk about with people. So there's a number of explanations for this cohabitation effect. So let's just go back to the sense that's existed for the last 40 years. And by the way, it's an interesting thing because what's ironic about the cohabitation effect is that for the most part, you could say in this particular area of study, it's the single greatest thing that the most people believe that the least amount of research has supported is the idea that living together before marriage will give you a leg up in marriage. And in fact, even to this day, even though many scientists in this area will say that it's no longer associated with risk in marriage, and again, I'm telling you that's really for a very small group, it's very hard. You can find a couple of little places in the zillions of studies on cohabitation before marriage in the last few decades. You can find a couple little places, some in little subsamples or in a different sample here, where you maybe could argue that there's a bit of a benefit for some groups. But overwhelmingly, that's not true. And so it's a great example of a giant disconnect because, oddly enough, and surveys show this is the number one thing that young people believe they can do to give themselves a leg up in marriage, is to live together before marriage. And I won't go into this in this talk, but the worst reason of all somebody can tell you that they're about to move in with somebody is to test the relationship. That's the worst answer because they usually think there's something to test, they're usually right, and it's not a good thing to be thinking going into it, which I'll explain. One of the major reasons that researchers talk about why cohabitation has been associated with increased risk in marriage is selection effects. Selection effects are things that are true of the individual. They're true about their background, their lives. For example, family instability, parents never married, parents never married, having some history of problems with substance abuse, other kinds of things, all sorts of things, poverty, make it more likely that somebody's going to either cohabit before marriage or cohabit on one of the riskier paths before marriage. And those are called selection effects because those same things, independently of living together, also predict struggling in marriage. So the researcher that would like to say, and there's many, this is all selection effects, will say, well, it's not really anything about living together. It's that this person already had baked into their cake, if you will, these higher risks in terms of how well they were going to do in their relationship. That's what selection effects are. And I just want to say there's a lot of evidence for selection being involved here. There's a lot of evidence for selection effects being part of the story. Some people are already at greater risk. And now I'm going to explain to you why they are likely at even greater risk in terms of cohabiting in certain ways. But it is a fair point to say some people are a lot greater risk than others just going into the whole shooting match. Now, a more causal, that's sort of it's causal, but it's not so much related to the decisions and behavior of the individual. There's another way to think about the experience of cohabitation, and this is really our theory that's gained a lot of traction in the field. This is really quite accepted at this point, that another part of the risk, and this is the one that part of the risk that people don't see, is that cohabitation increases the inertia in the relationship and makes it harder to break up. So if you compare cohabiting versus dating, not to marriage, cohabiting versus dating, which is the most interesting comparison here, you can see that living together has a lot more, remember I talked about constraint commitment a few minutes ago? Living together has a lot more constraints than dating, all of the things being equal. And inertia is this property in physics that speaks to how much energy it would take to move something a different direction or take it from where it is and move it another place. How much energy would you have to apply? And cohabitation would take more energy to move to a different place or to end than dating. Now, I got this insight, and I'm not going to belabor this one, but I just want to give you a sense of this finding. You don't have to, some of you might have math anxiety. This isn't that complicated, but this survey data goes all the way back to the 1990s, and this is where I really first had this insight about inertia. This is a national sample. It's not a huge national sample, but it's a national sample, pretty nice little phone survey. And what I'm comparing here is people who said they lived with their partner before marriage and people who didn't, so that's the bottom part, and then male versus female, and this is one of my measures of dedication. What that essentially says, now the female difference there actually isn't statistically significant. If that size of a difference was maintained with a larger sample, it would be, but that's not the interesting story here. The difference between the two blue lines for the males is big. And let me just put it in English what this means. The men, everybody's married now. And I think I either picked married within 10 years or 5 years to get everybody sort of in a similar time frame of life and when I did this analysis. The men who were living, who said they lived with their wives before marriage, while married, now that they're married, were reporting that they were substantially less dedicated. Remember I told you what dedication is? Substantially less dedicated to their wives than the males who said they hadn't lived with their wives before marriage. Everybody with me on that? So, I'm sitting there, I'm thinking about this. This is one of the probably three big epiphany moments in my life intellectually. I'm looking at this. Then, by the way, this is my favorite kind of day. I'm looking at data and I'm not talking to anybody. and just thinking. And I'm just looking at this and it just dropped into my head. Some of you, not all of you, some of you in that group married somebody you wouldn't have married if you'd never moved in with them. Now think about that. Think about what I said about constraint, what I said about inertia. Some of you married somebody that you wouldn't have married, and you were never that committed to this person. It's not that you had it and you lost it. This is carrying all the way through from things that were there already before marriage. What you did is you just sort of froze it in place by making it harder to break up by moving in. So that was the insight. Now, I won't say anything formally in the rest of the talk about male-female. If you want to talk more about that, you can ask a question in a bit when I get through my points. Sometimes we get the big difference in males and females on some of these dimensions related to commitment, like this first starting finding, and other times we don't. When we do get the finding, it's almost always in the same direction, and it's usually about 2-1 that the male will be the lower committed person when it's on one of these more less clear, more ambiguous kind of paths. Males are, you have a much more likelihood of an asymmetrically committed relationship, and when you have an asymmetrically committed relationship, 2 or 3-1, it's the male that's going to be on the low end in terms of the commitment. So here's the crux of inertia and cohabitation. So there's more constraints on average in living together than dating, all other things being equal. And this is what people do not easily see until you point it out to them. You're all campus leaders and thought leaders, and you think a lot about these things. People tend to not see this until you point it out to them, and then they tend to be able to see it, which is really valuable. So we've tested this theory of inertia in a number of ways that I'll cover pretty quickly. One is, and this was the first major prediction, is, and again, I'm just thinking scientifically here, it should be a non-factor for those who've already clarified a mutually really clear commitment before they started living together, because they've already decided, you're my future. The inertia isn't going to be part of a problem with cohabitation for those couples. So the prediction is, those who are already engaged, for example, before they start living together, we predicted aren't going to look as risky, they're going to look nearly as well or as good in marriage as everybody else. Because that follows directly from this idea of inertia, which is exactly what we find. And in fact, this has now been tested at least 6 times that I know of. Several of these are our studies, but not all of them. And this is a unique thing, by the way, because many interesting findings in social science tend to happen just one time and don't tend to get replicated. This is a lot of replication. Every one of these is a different sample, different set of analyses, findings, assumptions, etc., and that prediction holds. So there's one major prediction. Now, I want to be clear about something, that couples who cohabit prior to having plans for marriage, many turn out fine. So I'm not saying that everybody in that group, again, speaking to you as a scientist at the moment, I'm not saying everybody in that group is at risk. There's a subset of people that are at greater risk. But that's the key. That's the greater risk. Now, I'll comment briefly on this, and I'll do it in a very simple way. As a social scientist, I will be upset and anxious if my sons were to live together with who they eventually marry if they did so before engagement. If I put my father theological hat, more traditional hat on, I'll be upset if they live together at all before marriage. And I just want you to know those two hats don't put me in quite the same place. I'm more speaking to you at the moment about the scientific hat. Now, I'm going to mention a few other findings, and it's important to have a sense of the sample. You don't need to memorize this. There won't be a quiz in a short bit. But one of our favorite studies is a sample that we recruited about 7 years ago and followed for 5 years, which was a national sample in the United States of people who were in serious romantic relationships who were not married, where we followed them pretty intensely. And I don't mean like around their house and stuff, but they filled out really extensive questionnaires on their relationships and their lives every 4 to 6 months. And so we knew a lot about their things, how things worked out over time for them. We followed people if they broke up in one relationship into the next. We followed a group into marriage that I'll talk about in a minute. And here's one of the kinds of studies also testing this inertia idea that comes from that. So one of the, there's more technical points on this slide than I need for my purpose here except to remind me, one of the more sophisticated analyses that we've done on this is to look at the same group of people before and after they cohabited on different variables. And so that looks like this. So this transition here, this is the point at which people start to cohabit and taking this large sample that we have a lot of measurement over time. Here's one of the things that happens in that sample is when people move in together, the dedication had been increasing up until that point and then it levels off. And I just want to comment here for sake of making a point. That's not leveling off high enough. You'd usually want to see on this particular version of my measures, you'd want to see a dedication score up above that 6 range. The highest number is 7. This is not leveling off at a super high place in terms of what you'd want to see for somebody before marriage. You'll also see over there that negative communication takes an immediate jump up and then starts to accelerate. People start to have more conflict. Galena really nailed this point that a lot of times what people are doing in cohabitation is they are combining a couple of stages that are really challenging in life. One is they're still trying to figure out, do we have a future? So that's not even clarified yet for many couples. And they're having to start to negotiate who does what. How do we manage this thing? And you get more negativity. Now, my favorite finding in this chunk here, this is one of our measures of constraints. And what I want you to notice here, just like what we talk about with inertia, that's going up very slowly. Then they move in together, huge jump up in material constraints, and then acceleration in the rate of accumulation of material constraints. So this fits very much another aspect of what we predict by inertia. Now, here's why inertia matters. The rest of what I'm going to talk about before we get to some questions, is going to be about sequence and about timing. Constraints develop out of sequence related to dedication. That's the problem with inertia. Normally, you'd want to see dedication really fully forming, ripening, being strong and clear, and then it becomes harder to break up, and that's often not what we see. Norval Glenn, a sociologist who's passed on now, great sociologist, he had a term for how this foreshortens a person's search process for the best mate. He called it premature entanglement. that people become entangled too soon in too many ways in their relationships. And essentially what that does is that takes them out of the mixing around, moving around, really looking for the best partner they can match with. They're kind of out of the game too soon because they sort of froze themselves too quickly, sometimes in the wrong place. Now, the sliding versus deciding, I want to tell you where this language came from and then make some key conceptual points. There was a paper by an Australian sociologist, Lindsay, in 2000, and she talked about a form of this kind of way that people, when they cohabit these days, many couples, it's not like a discrete transition. They sort of slide into it. They sort of gradually move into it, sometimes without even noticing. A number of sitcoms have done pieces on this because it's sort of a funny thing, like, oh, we're cohabiting now, which really kind of happens to a lot of people. Wendy Manning and Pam Smock did a qualitative study, in-depth interviews with people a little over a decade ago, and then published that in 2005, where they showed that over half of the couples that they talked to didn't describe a decision or talking about it or thinking about it. It was more like, well, you know, one was over there three nights a week, and then four nights a week, and then starts to leave a toothbrush, and maybe starts to have a little part of a drawer where they leave some clothes, and now it's got part of the closet, and now it's leaving more and more stuff. And then somebody's lease is up at some point, or somebody gets kicked out, or just sort of, they just sort of drift in to living together. Very, very common. Quantitatively, we find something very similar. In this big data set I was just talking about, that among non-marrieds, roughly two-thirds report sliding into cohabiting as opposed to talking about it, making a decision. In contrast to sliding, commitments are decisions. And in fact, one of my favorite one-liners about commitment, if you're making a commitment, whatever you're doing is a commitment, you're making a choice to give up other choices. So commitment is a decision to give up other choices. You're making a choice to give up other choices. You can't be making a commitment of the deciding nature or the dedication nature by sliding into something. You can be increasing constraints and making it harder to move on that end of it without noticing what's going on. Now, people slide through all kinds of important relationship transitions now. People slide into having sex without being really deliberate about it, without making clear decisions. So you think about the hookup culture on campuses is one great example of that, greatly fueled by alcohol. Cohabitation, I just went through that really clearly. Pregnancy and childbearing. A lot of people in America now, they're not only not married, there's no particular sense of or intention about starting a family together, but now here's a baby. And again, there's this phenomena of many more children than ever before being born into low commitment contexts. So all these are really important relationship transitions that are now massively framed by sliding in terms of how they happen in our culture. We talked a lot about that. Here's one of the ways that a lot of our work's very accessible. Galena and I recently did a big report for the National Marriage Project that got a massive amount of media attention in August. And you can find a zillion things on the web about that. You can go get the report, you can read about it. I just want to mention a couple of the findings there related to these kind of transitions that I just mentioned. And don't worry about the nuances of the detail here, but I'll just highlight these few findings and then move on to the central sort of decision-making points I want to make. We looked at in this study, what we really were looking at was what things before marriage, either in prior relationships or one's history or the history with this particular relationship, what things before marriage relate to marital quality once married. So this is just a subsample of the kinds of things we looked at. So number of prior sexual partners. People with more sexual partners. Now, by the way, this finding is, I understand this and I can explain it well, but I'm not happy about the fact, but that finding's really for females and not for males. We didn't get the same clear association with number of sexual partners and lower marital quality for men that we got for females. I'll just leave that hanging out there. The median or most typical person had 5 sexual partners before marriage, which matches other surveys. That's pretty much typical for America at this point. If people ever cohabited with somebody other than the person they married, which was 39% of the sample, they were likely to report somewhat lower marital quality. If they had a child from prior relationships, especially if they were female, more likely to report lower marital quality. And if this relationship to the person that they married began as a hookup, they were more likely to report lower marital quality. Just giving you one that goes the other direction, if they had only ever had sex with the person they married, then they had higher marital quality. And by the way, we didn't get it measured really well what part of that is before or after marriage for the sample, but I can tell you most of that would be before marriage, just statistically. Now, I want to be a little circumspect about the findings before I get back to my conceptual model. I think we sometimes overstate findings. You'll hear something being statistically significant when a social scientist talks to you. That really just means it's not likely to be due by chance. You can within that have findings that are really large and really small. Statistical significance pertains to whether it's likely to actually be a thing. But it could be a small thing or a big thing. And sometimes I think we overstate findings. Nothing here, I'm again speaking scientifically, nothing here dooms a couple. There's a lot of people in life that do almost everything wrong, if you will, or on the risky side, and their marriages turn out fine. And there's a lot of people, tell me how reassuring this is, who do everything right and their marriages turn out really difficult and to struggle. What you're talking about when you talk about science is the averages. People have an edge if they do things more right, if they do things more on the lower risk path, they have an edge and greater likelihood of thriving and doing well. And if they do more of the things that are risky, they have a greater likelihood of not doing so well. So that's just being circumspectful. If you're very, I know some of you probably follow these two authors in particular. There was a massive amount of media to report. My two favorite pieces were one by Molly Hemingway and one by Catherine Jean Lopez. You can easily find those if you want. And that's another way you can access a little more about the study. So it occurred to me a while ago that there's a really interesting thing that happens with sliding versus deciding, that it's pretty powerful to explain to people, and that people kind of get it. And liberals and conservatives actually accept this particular model of mine that I'm going to talk about in terms of how we explain this pretty well. So let's imagine a couple of ways people could go about landing in a relationship or just doing a relationship transition. One is they get information, first step. Is this safe? You know, that's a good question. Is there compatibility? Is there a fit in this relationship? Is there some mutuality and commitment? A lot of people end up in relationships that are not mutual and commitment, and that's a real drag. Then there's some kind of decision. There's some sort of mindfulness. I'm choosing. I'm aware that I'm maybe giving up other options. I'm choosing to go through a particular transition. Transition could be sexual contact, cohabitation, pregnancy, childbearing, all the way up to marriage. Now, for my purposes here, I just want you to think about it this way. Every one of those transitions has, either by definition or at least potentially, is life-altering. Okay? And now, I know if I put my other hat on, I would say everyone is, by definition, life-altering. But I'm just talking to you in terms of what I could measure as a scientist. Let's just say all of these are potentially life-altering, and they're transitions that people often slide through. And this next box is really important. This is the constraint box, and it's always going to follow the yellow box because you're going to see one more progression like this. This is constraints. So that after I go through the transition, I don't have as many options as I had before. I have somehow, if you like statistics, I've lost some degrees of freedom in my life in terms of what I can still move, what's still free to vary. Because I've gone through this transition, I've got fewer options than I had before. If I chose it and it's part of my values and what I wanted to have happen in life, that's great. But we'll do the not so great path in a moment. I want you to notice also for a second the yellow box. Most arguments in our culture about sequence are vertically in the yellow box as opposed to what I'm doing here horizontally in the model. You see the difference? Both are very relevant arguments, but I'm not even having that argument right now. Although I would say that the vertical yellow box, that argument, that direction there, which many of you are very focused on in what you do here, that's a really important discussion. And part of why that's important, there's a lot of different kinds of reasons, but part of why it's important is it probably helps structure this part correctly on the horizontal side. So here's how people are usually doing things. Slide through the transition, just like before. I got fewer options after the transition than I had before. I'm just saying that's axiomatic, okay? That's there. And then I'm gonna get information about how that was. Is that a good place to be? Was that a good decision? Is there a compatibility here? Is there a fit here? Do you see what's wrong here? I'm gonna get the most valuable information about whether it was a good idea to do what I just did after I have the least amount of ability to do something with that information. I believe that's the major transformation in what's happened in our culture in terms of the new paradigm for how people do dating and mating. And they're very often, and there's some great implications of this, sliding into something that's potentially life-altering after the slide, having fewer options than they had before, and then getting this very valuable information. And here's one of the great one-liners from this talk. What this really means is that very often lots of people are giving up options before they made a choice. You can use that line. You can work that line when you're talking with people, because this is the last thing that young people in our kind of society and culture want to do is give up any options. In fact, that's a big problem, is that they never want to give up any options. But certainly they don't want to give them up when they're not even seeing that they're doing it, but people are doing this all the time, is losing options without recognizing that that's what's happening. In contrast, now I want you to notice this, healthy commitment isn't about not losing options, it's deciding when you're going to lose them for a very good reason. When you're really committed to something, you're going to lose options, you're going to increase your constraints. That's what commitment is. When you're sliding, it doesn't have that intentionality, it's not this nature of healthy commitment. Deciding matters, because deciding sets up stronger follow-throughs. Even in people that are married now, I know, I'm convinced, we have many more couples than we would have had in the past among married couples who kind of slid all the way into where they are right now. And that there wasn't a clear decision or clear decisions at a key time where they still had all of their options, and that undermines intention. And what it does is it undermines this strong sense internally that I chose you. I chose this path. Life and family and marriage can be hard enough at times when we have a clear sense that we chose what we're doing. I think it'd be very difficult at times for people when they have a sense of, how did I get here? You know, if I slid all the way up to that, how did I get here? Now, before we do Q&As, I'm going to play a 4-minute video. I'm also part of a team where we develop a lot of relationship education materials that are especially used in a lot of different government and community agencies. One of the things that we have that's super popular that is not available on the internet because it doesn't work with our business model to put it on the internet, it's the kind of thing we do on the business side that's the most expensive thing that we produce. And this is just 4-minute video to highlight some of this idea about how people sort of are losing options without awareness. Now, this little video is really tuned toward a moment that's sort of in a different place than where many of you are trying to interact with the culture around sexual integrity and purity. This is more meeting people more often where they are, and really trying to get this idea planted in their minds that very often they're losing options, they're becoming intertwined, and they don't recognize the implications of it. So let's do some questions and answer. You can see where all of that goes, that I believe we live in a culture now where people don't see that this is even happening. They don't see how they're locking themselves out of options and alternatives, and people often can respond much better than a lot of other places we can start talking with people when you're helping them see how that happens too easily in their life, how that happens too easily when it comes to dating and mating at this point.
Thank you. Just before my question, I'm surprised you didn't use the Ambrose Bierce definition of love as a state of temporary insanity curable by marriage.
I like that.
You mentioned, of course, the cohabitation effect and then your list of premarital experiences as predictors of marital quality, which, if they are truly causal in any significant degree, are of huge importance in giving advice to people. And then you did very honestly mention the possibility of selection effect, meaning that it could just be a correlation, not a causal effect. And then you went on to your inertia hypothesis, which I don't think you said, but you seem to imply strongly that the inertia effect was indeed a causal effect. And therefore, that is the justification for advising against this kind of behavior. But I could not find in there evidence that that's a causal effect. I'm wondering why the inertia effect could not also simply be a correlation.
So let me clarify two things about what you raised. One is, and sociologists and psychologists that study cohabitation tend to use terms in one way. I was recently in a little bit of a debate with an economist, so I'll just clarify a couple of terms. So an economist, and actually a lot of social scientists, would say anything's selection effects are causal too. They're just not causal on the path that you're focused on. So, and I don't care so much about the distinction, but I am exactly saying what you said. The inertia is a much stronger inference of causality in terms of it being related to consequential choices in people's behavior, things that people do that have real consequences. And selection's related to the outcome, and inertia's related to the outcome. So essentially, and I didn't present everything, but with inertia, every single prediction that it makes holds. The increased inertia or the increased constraints predict a greater likelihood of staying together. That's probably the part that you're missing. Greater likelihood of staying together, net of everything else, including dedication. So when people have increased their constraints in a dating relationship or a cohabiting relationship, when they've increased their constraints, they are more likely to remain together no matter how dedicated they are to each other. So all of these different elements, inertia is essentially a causal theory, as in consequential, that actually, if you'll notice, it completely embraces, it has no trouble with the issue of selection effects. Because what I would say in the complete package there is, yeah, a lot of people are more likely than a lot of other people to cohabit in the ways that are riskier, for example, serial cohabitation, cohabitation before engagement, etc. And then what inertia does is it adds this element on top of it, it now making it harder to break up and harder to move on. So it adds this element to why that behavior has a causal, consequential implication for future outcomes that goes beyond just the amount of risk that was already baked in. Ironically, the people that are at the most risk for that happening are people that were already at greater risk for not doing so well in marriage. So it's a compounded risk as opposed to just separate. They often go together. I see this hand next, right. Yeah, go ahead and stand up when I point at you, and then we'll get you a mic.
So kind of along the same lines, in your point about the cohabitation effect, the first point, it's all about the people who cohabitate. So these people, along the same lines, that they have a predisposition because of, say, being born into a non-committal context. So I know, for me, just devil's advocate, I have very close friends who would ask this similar question along these lines, I believe, that are those, is that non-marital, or excuse me, non-committal context being a negative thing or something that would predispose someone to something that we as a society would see as bad, i.e. a lack of success in marriage. So are these societal constructs really what need to be done away with, this premise that a non-committal context being born into that is a bad thing? Is that just simply a construct that we devise that now is imposed upon us? So he would say that what really needs to change is the society that gives less benefits or less hope in whatever ways to people who are born into these situations and therefore predisposed. Is that just a construct?
So I think of it this way, that the there's a book that's very popular right now. Brad Wilcox, many of you know Brad, he gave a really nice summary of it by Isabel Sawhill at Brookings called Generation Unbound. It is the book right now that everybody's talking about in the policy family world. And as Brad said, and I think this would fit well for a lot of you, that it's a great diagnosis, not a good solution, the way he describes it, because their solution's all about long-acting birth control. And I know different people in the room here would have different positions of that, both theologically and scientifically. But what's interesting, her diagnosis of society reflects something that's very profound. 15, 20 years ago still, you would find social scientists still arguing pretty strongly about whether marriage mattered at all or whether the commitment context of a child mattered at all. This is like a sea change, and this is like one of the only positive sea changes in all of what we've seen happen in the last 40 or 50 years, is that that argument seems over. Now, the what I mean by over is this. You can still find some people that don't want to say that marriage means anything or that matters, but you can find very few that won't acknowledge that children do best when they're raised by their own two parents in the context of a strong commitment, in the context of marriage. Seems like virtually that's a universal belief now in social science. I don't mean that there's not 15% or so that still wouldn't believe that, but it seems to be very true. And what's fascinating that's happening right now is you can see more people who are mainstream, heavyweight liberals, really strong thinkers, who are not social conservatives or traditionalists, essentially getting increasingly, I wouldn't say anxious, but they're getting in their public statements increasingly concerned about the level of disconnection and the way things are falling apart. And my summary line for that you picked up on well is that we just, forget the divorce rate for a second. I mean, that's really leveled off over the last 30 years and isn't going higher. It may not be going rapidly lower. The number that's not leveling off, that keeps increasing, are the number of children born in low commitment contexts. So back full circle to your question. Now, the pessimistic part of the answer to your question is people vary, and Isabel Sawhill has been having a lot of interviews with different people about this. People vary a lot in how pessimistic or optimistic they are about what you could do to change culture around that. I'm actually a pessimist on it in terms of just, there's a brutally scientific part of my mind that kind of pushes everything else around in my head at times. And I'm not optimistic for seeing that come back. I am optimistic about trying. I'm optimistic about the fact that things that you all do and what you focus on is trying to bring that back and trying to restore it. But the macro forces in our society working against you are huge, and I just want to be clear about that. You already know that. I'm not telling you something you don't know, but we're watching really big stuff happen that has long-term huge consequences. Another question? I'll look over here in case don't want to miss anybody on this side of the room. Now, you notice the oxytocin sprayed people here. Particularly quiet because they don't have any questions. They don't question anything anymore. So, at least if I say it. So.
So you talked a little bit about how if couples have this mutual clear understanding that they're in a sense destined for marriage, that they have a better success rate if they cohabitate before that tends to work out okay. But I think with the misunderstanding of what marriage is, that it's an intense emotional attachment. That people have a misunderstanding of that, so when they experience these high levels of dopamine, of oxytocin, that they think, oh, we must be destined for marriage. So how can we clarify with people, because they might think that they fall into that select group of people, how do we clarify that with people and help them understand that mating is a better option as opposed to cohabitation?
So how can I clarify with people that waiting is a good option? One of the ways, and I think about this stuff a lot, because with the teams that I work on and the things that we do, we're always thinking about different groups and what's the starting point of the message. Keep in mind, most of my colleagues are liberal anyway. But you can think about the work that you do and just imagine 10 different individuals you could talk with and work with. The starting point for your discussion with them could be at really 10 very different places. You could have one person that's like just within inches of what you already believe, and you can start talking with them more deeply about philosophical or theological issues or whatever in terms of trying to help them. And then you got people over here that there's nothing in common in your worldview about marriage and family with where they're at. The further you go down that path where you're not at any kind of similar starting point, I think the kinds of messages that actually start to work with people is the idea of slowing down and waiting. And what I gave you this morning here is a really compelling way to talk with people about the importance of going slower, waiting, and not giving up a lot of options too soon. You can start to get people to see that, I don't know if I agree with you about this or this or about this or that, but I can kind of see how if I'm not careful, if I let things just happen to me, that I can actually be impacting the whole rest of my life. See, this is what people don't see and think. The picture on the front of the National Marriage Project report is a picture of a little baby wearing a t-shirt that says, "What happens in Vegas doesn't always stay in Vegas." And I really believe that your generation has completely bought into a mindset that whatever's going on here in my 20s until I kind of settle down at 28, 29, 30, is non-consequential for the rest of my life. It's not going to affect me. And that's really not true. As another one of my most liberal colleague of all is a woman named Marlene Pearson, and she just completely believes in everything I'm telling you right now. She would say it in some ways even more passionate than I'm saying it. Her one-liner for talking with, she works with high-risk people and people that are more disadvantaged in the context of a community college in Madison, Wisconsin, and just has lots of great insights. Her one-liner for people is this: your love life is not neutral. So a lot of times, what we're really trying to do in terms of getting people to think about waiting, there's a lot of things you might want somebody to believe. But your initial step is trying to help people that haven't been told this or encouraged to believe this in any way in the culture, that in fact what happens in their love life, in their sex life, in their dating life, whatever they want to call it, is going to affect all of their future outcomes. It's going to affect them in terms of education. It's going to affect them in terms of being successful career, likelihood of having a family that really works out, likelihood of success in marriage. And one other thing that your question made me think about, and this relates to the cohabitation thing. If you want to talk with somebody, for example, about, well, we're engaged, so why would we wait to move in together? There's one other thing, and we don't have findings on this, but it shows up a lot in things that very smart people say. And I mean either very smart researchers or thinkers or just really smart. I hear this more often, not because I'm bringing it up, but I hear it in the younger people that I'm talking with about why they would wait till marriage to move in. And they get something exactly right, which is if we move in now, the transition into marriage is not going to seem like any big thing. That's really smart. Because I really think people do best if they think about the transition into marriage as like a portal in time, and there is a before, like there's a line, there's a before, and there's an after. I'm stepping into something new and different now when I take those vows, when I marry. And nobody's got a great beat on that yet in terms of findings, but I think it's a pretty profoundly important idea that it's very valuable for people to preserve the maximum sense that there was me before I made this step, before this transition, and then there's me after, and that's a different new me with some amount of transformation happening. How about the one way back there?
I have a couple of what I think are quick questions. The first one is just when you talked about very selective in which cohabitation is not a negative risk factor for marriage future. Are those three select groups on your slide, or is it just one select group that shares all three of those characteristics?
I would bet it's one group that shares all three characteristics. Zillions of blog pieces you can find. One of the ones that I've written this year that really deals with that is the fragment of the title is something about and other consequential choices of researchers, something like that. If you look through my blog entries, I deal a lot with this issue that a lot of times what social scientists can do, and this isn't really a great thing, but social science is very affected by the biases and what people decide to do. And what I talk about, what Galena and I talk about in that paper, are a lot of my blog entries are really papers, frankly. They're not like little blog entries. I just have trouble doing that. Is talk about the fact that different ways people can construct their model statistically, you can sort of determine what you want to talk about at the end of the model, because you can put enough things in. In this case, I talk about in that paper this metaphor that I like a lot, is you can think about this room that a lot of people go through that's risky, that, and you can think about it as having many doors. They all go into the same room. The room is related to greater risk in marriage, and going through that room is going to be, I think, causally, consequentially related to greater risk in marriage. But different people get in the room through different doors. For some people, it's sex too soon. For some people, it's when a baby came along. For some people, it's more by how they started to cohabit, but it's all the same room.
I was just going to ask, I liked the video very much. You talked about the, partly because it, frame sliding as locking down, and that's a very negative association for a lot of people.
Yep.
You also mentioned the risk that people never want to commit. Do you show a different video to people who you think we want to say eventually do make that commitment kind of video?
Here's the way I'd answer that. So like I said, and again, I'm not really good with commercials, but that video you can get on DVD if you find that that would be useful playing it. There's three cards that are around of materials from our team. There's another one that they just reproduced in a really nice version of the best talk I ever gave to a group of married couples about commitment. I think it's about a 30-minute video. It's funny, it's entertaining, and they did a really nice job by adding some animations to it. And that one would be more, if you want a tool right now, and you notice that one's 30 minutes and this one's 4 minutes, that's something you could play with somebody in that context and have, you could think about that as really starting a lot of discussions. Because while I'm talking to married people, I'm talking about the benefits about being committed. I'm talking about the different ways that it's manifested in a person's life in terms of their behavior and the choices they make. And I think that if you like media, at least anything that we have, that would be one way you could start a discussion, because it would frame a lot of what's tricky and important about commitment in life while deeply embedded in the mix of the idea that there's a lot of benefits of really deep commitment and maintain commitment in marriage. So that's another option if you like it. Oh, I can get you next. Ryan, I know I'm making you. He got the most oxytocin, so let's just see how this question is impacted.
I'm highly infatuated with the lecture. Oh,
glad you clarified.
So much, I was wondering if we could get the slides afterwards in an email, if possible, because I'm sure we'd exercise with
people. Yeah, we can. You can get the slides, and I think you also, there'll be a variation of this presentation. It won't have that little video in it, because we don't let that to be streaming on the internet, but you can get this talk, and I could also send you the slides.
My question is, thank you, by the way. My question is, you folks, quite a bit on the negative effects of sliding. So one can create this picture of this is what you ought not to do, such as sliding and locking down. But what would you recommend as creating this more positive picture of deciding that is this is the alternative that we can look at? Now, you showed some of the benefits compared to sliding on how deciding makes more of a difference, hence like deciding that this is when we're going to get married. From what I understand in your study, before I do, decisions are kind of milestones that inform the narrative of a couple's relationship. Could you describe more on that and clarify for us how we can use that as a picture for the alternative of deciding versus sliding?
So I think one of the ways you can do that, now you can tell I have a bias. I think the most powerful way into the deciding part, the image that just came to my mind is if you imagine somebody walking along in Rocky Mountain National Park in a pretty high up place where there's sort of like a ledge. And it's beautiful and it's gorgeous, but there's this path on the side of this whatever they're walking, and then there's a drop off. I do think you get people's attention about the path a little bit by really paying attention to the drop-off. Because just as you really hooked into the lock-in point, which, by the way, I would not have known to really focus on that language, but my team obviously did, who also tends to be younger than me. They really nailed the lock-in thing in the video. So I believe strongly in that. But the selling point on decisions would be something, any variation of this idea, in addition to what I already said, which is take control of your destiny. Now, I wouldn't go so far with that as to convey to somebody that if they make all the right decisions, everything always turns out right, actually, or well. Life can be really challenging almost sometimes because you made all the right decisions, right? But I do think you can make a pretty strong selling point to people on the idea of taking charge, being intentional. That's almost too much of a cliche, but making decisions about things and milestones in their relationship is managing their destiny. They're enforcing a script. They're building a script together in a world that is now scriptless. Thank you very much.